I make the world graphical.
I add value through my products.
I am an animator.
I am a filmmaker. I develop trends.
I transform designs to reality.
I create environments.
I translate stories to furniture.
I design experiences.
I'm an immersive media designer.
I design mobility.
This is not only a design institute.
This is a design lab.
Join us in our design movement.
Good afternoon. Welcome to the 7th edition of MIT ID webinar series. I'm Hélène Thébault, the Faculty Coordinator of Transcultural Design Master's Program here at MIT Institute of Design. In this edition of the webinar today, we'll try to enlighten students about transcultural design, and we'll be discussing the dialogues between design and culture. After that, we'll be addressing the questions from the audience. So today with me, I have Ishita and Amit. Thank you so much for joining.
Thank you, Helen. I'm Amit. I'm the founder director of Plus One Initiative and Zealous Design Solutions. Zealous Design Solutions is a product design consultancy, and Plus One is a social enterprise. And I've been teaching design since 2007. So it's a pleasure to be here and share my thoughts.
Thank you. I'm Ishita, and I'm a mental health illustrator and advocate, and I assist with pedagogy in transcultural design at MIT Institute. So thank you for having me.
I guess to begin, I would like, Amit, maybe your perception on the stage of innovation today in India.
Great. India has become, I think, the hub for innovation, you can say, because the mindsets are changing. You can see a lot of global players are coming to India. They're trying to set up and understand India as a market. And though it looks as obvious for any global player to come to India, it's not that simple. A lot of work that goes into it, and it's a part of innovation that is happening. So, you know, we have IKEA, we have Decathlon, which is very well accepted. But at the same time, there's a lot of work that has gone into by these companies to understand and innovate to cater to the market in India. And I think that's where we are at. We are at a junction where innovation does help tremendously to address different issues, may it be social, may it be economical, and it's the need of the hour. So I would say India is really a great market for innovation. At the same time, India is innovating tremendously in all fields to be able to be at speed with the world. So that's something quite interesting nowadays.
Yeah, I think what is very interesting is that it is a good space, and it has a lot of potential, but it's also a tough market to crack sometimes because of the very varied and diverse cultures that we have within one country and all the nuances. Yeah. And to understand that, it's a lot of time spent.
Absolutely.
And I think that's the idea of transcultural there, you know, that in the present Indian context, we are adapting to the global perspectives as well, which is necessary for, I think, any country to grow.
Absolutely.
Absolutely, yeah, which is always true. Like one of the main learnings, I believe, in the course and looking at culture is looking at it as a dynamic phenomena.
Yeah.
In every culture at any point of time, culture is dynamic, and there's always adaptation and borrowing ideas or technologies from here and there. And I also believe that's when, you know, the greatest innovations and solutions happen, especially in terms of design. So that's also the belief of L'École de Design Nord-Atlantique. So the French Institute of Design, with which MIT Institute of Design is partnering with to offer this 2-year master's degree in transcultural design. So we have at present students from France and from India enrolled in the course, looking at this dynamic culture.
Yeah, I think the word transcultural is so new to a lot of people. In fact, it was new to me as well. I am not at all excluded to that. Even if I was in the field of design, studied it and worked in it. Mm-hmm. I guess it's a very important field. And I think if you can just talk more about how students will approach it here in this country, it'll be great.
Yes, absolutely. It's also a bit wide as a term, transcultural. And it's also meant to reflect an approach towards design and not a discipline-centric way of looking at the industry. So that's one main shift that has to happen, and that's maybe at first an obstacle to sort of understand a picture. What can that course and that profession be? So it's a master's degree program. So the students who joined, they have completed the bachelor's in design before. And that would be in different disciplines of design, namely product, industrial design, interior design, exhibition design, also interactive design, user experience, but also graphics, you know, mm-hmm. like it's really varied. Yeah. In fact, the more variety we have, the better, I would say. Especially when the students on campus work on group projects, they form teams which are truly interdisciplinary mm-hmm. and really complete that way. And they can work on projects for companies here, local companies, but also international, also institutions or Absolutely. NGOs in a very complete way. And the teams, the project that the students work on as part of the campus projects, but also as part of their internships and the thesis projects that they carry on individually, they can sort of decide how their specialty, how the field of design they have studied before is going to contribute to the specific project, the specific situation. For example, one student had come from interior design background initially, studied in France and joined the India Studio here, Transcultural Design Program. And she has decided to work on water treatment and recycling rain water to distribute it again into the building so that it becomes drinkable. So she that was her end of study project. So it developed as a facade with cells that are recycling, treating the water, which is then redistributed in the building. And she then carried out her final internship at the fourth semester, at the end of the course, in China, in an architecture company who is really placing environmental design and sustainability at the center of everything they do. And she's still working there at the moment. So that just shows you within the course, how do you, you know, choose how your previous backgrounds and your internship experience is going to lead you to your career.
Absolutely. I think I interacted with some students as well. And what I realized, and as you mentioned rightly, that transcultural design is an approach. It's not like a specific field in which you do your master's in. It basically, as if I'm not wrong, it works a lot about on terms of design thinking. And that's what brings it together in terms of being able to do the research as well as understand and build insights, as well as go and build ideas from those ideas, prototype something, and from prototype, go and test it. So this entire cycle, and though it is quite widely known, I think, mm-hmm. unless you practice it,
Exactly.
through a project. And mm-hmm. the beauty of the project that I saw was none of them were on the same line. Mm-hmm. And even if they're doing individual projects, right, it's not something which is, they can learn from each other tremendously. So there is a huge amount of peer learning. And the moment they come in a team together, I think that's something that they can exchange because their backgrounds are different. So everyone has a different take on design, their understanding or research. And that becomes like a healthy debate at times to be able to build on ideas on that. So that's something I really liked about what mm-hmm. The students are learning. And also it allows different way of expression because they come from a different background. Each one has a different way of expression.
Yeah.
And that is something that is not molded. And that's something that I really liked in terms of being able to see a variety, even in one class, a variety of projects, which was a great learning, even for me.
So I think that's a big advantage. It's a very unique advantage of this course, which is definitely highlighted in the sense that everyone is coming from a different discipline. Absolutely. And it's not focused on just one discipline, like you both said. And I think what really happens is there's a sharing of understanding and information. And to students who come to India to from France to study here, and also they work on their dissertations and theses in the second year, which is actually absolutely quite fantastic to see how they're looking at things. And so how long is the thesis duration usually?
So the entire course is 2 years, so it's subdivided in four semesters. The first one, for the French students who come here to India for the first time, after like a month of being on campus for orientation and transcultural workshops, they go for internships in India, so that they also have an experience of working in a design studio, a professional environment here in India, and also figuring out a few things on their own without the campus. The Indian students, they have the opportunity also to go to France at that time. So we really have a crossing of students in the first semester. That's important for the Indian students also. So they go to the French campus of L'École de Design, not Atlantique, in the west of France. It's important so that they acquire the methodology specific to the school, which is of course carried out here for the rest of the program. Then, in the second semester, it's spent on campus, and we have different courses such as design research, innovation strategy, a couple of modules also looking at entrepreneurship, like intellectual property rights, basic and accounting and management principles. And then we have mostly group projects. The learning is given in theory and small practice in those modules, which is then carried out for a longer time in the group projects. Like I said, always in partnership with companies or NGOs. And throughout the semester, parallelly in working in groups, each student is also defining a topic for the dissertation, for the end of study project, and which is then carried out fully in the third semester, again here on campus. So by the third semester, it's mostly working individually, building a network of professionals also in and out of the campus, depending on the, you know, depending on the topics and what kind of inputs the student would need to bring in. That can be from the medical sector, that can be from scientific, philosophical sometimes. It's always changing. That's really fascinating, actually. And this is then the final semester, fourth one is a final internship. And the model here for the final internship is to continue, you know, for each student working on possibly the project that they are developing within, again, a professional environment. So here we have startup hubs and different studios of design in India, which are really eager and welcoming for this model to take forward student projects. If not, students work on broad teams, and that can happen anywhere in the world. There's no geographic restriction. It's more studied and approved in coherence with the projects that they have done.
That's very interesting, because I think one point you made was about entrepreneurship, and very few schools are being able to encourage that. Normally, the tendency has been so far about being able to gain the skills and find a job. But I think through a project and more of being independent, exploration and understanding. And I think the beauty of it is that if you are able to work on a project which is your own, that will really encourage you to take it up as a startup or a company to lead into. So even though you can get mentorship, it will really lead in you to start and understand the nitty-gritties of it and to be able to build this into a really strong base, I would say, during the course itself to maybe take this as an opportunity to launch it as a business. So I think that's something which is very important for the students to understand. And this is the time where they can take the most risks.
Yes. Right?
And that is where best opportunity is, because yeah. there's nothing that they are going to lose time or anything. They are going to be able to learn, ask, and they can ask any questions and they will gain out of it. So entrepreneurship, I think, is the key which this course would allow the students to develop as a skill. The model is going to be there, but to be able to be more independent and be responsible for their own acts becomes something which is that this model can give it to. So that's what I take it from what I understand from
you. Absolutely. I mean, I never studied anything like that. I had to learn it on my own after college. And I think it's a great space to at least have the students explore that topic of entrepreneurship. And especially in such a changing environment and our economies are changing. So we no longer just do one thing anymore. We have a lot of careers, actually. We end up doing a lot of things.
Yeah.
So it's a very important thing.
Yeah.
I think you're right that it's the best time to do it at this age in life. And I believe it's also the right space.
Absolutely.
To me, India is one of the best, if not the best place right now to start and build your business as a designer, but also with allies from other professions.
Absolutely.
The you know, the context right now, the economy, the entire atmosphere, and also only the, you know, the average age of the population we have here in India is pretty young.
Yeah.
It's a big phenomena, really important as opposed to other countries in the world, and that's really, really stimulating.
I think that's something that really helps the students. So not only, so a lot of times we think as Indians that we know about the culture, but when you actually start researching and if you actually start understanding, take up a problem and try to dig into it, we realize how much different it is than what we thought.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's what this program will allow the students to do, because a lot of times we are, in our education system, we are given more of what you can say, a unidirectional opinion.
Mm-hmm.
There's a book, there is a the question paper, and you have to answer it, and that's it. But to be able to explore it and form our own opinion about anything that you can take up, and then from that opinion, you say, okay, this is something, there's a problem that I've identified. And what I realized, like when I was going through the students, someone was working on mental health, which was a surprise for me as well, because being an Indian, it is still at this age very difficult for us to come out and openly accept and work on it. But coming from a different culture where this is more openly accepted and spoken about, and it's been taken well, someone coming and trying to address it for India also becomes very important. So taking these kind of issues, which are always are sort of a new age issues, like depression, you know, work-life balance, stress. Once you start tackling it as an entrepreneur or just as a group and able to research on it, it really changes the way we start looking at a problem. And there could be a great startup or a great solution for it, which we tend to ignore because we never looked at it from that lens. But this course allows you to, you know, open up your horizon and look at it in different lens and to be able to take it from there.
Yeah,
absolutely. That's where the magic happens.
Yeah.
You know, when students of both countries can collaborate for short or long projects, or even like in the entire course. There are, of course, obstacles for French students coming here and study, carry out research, carry out dissertation. Obviously, a main obstacle is language.
Absolutely.
But there are also many advantages in not understanding anything, you know, and being very ignorant, but in a positive sense, and pointing out things that maybe students from India are used to the environment, even me by now, you know, you don't really notice or pay attention to.
Yeah.
And sometimes you have really important clues about situations, about problems, that design can really act upon.
Address.
And that's you know, the whole point of the course, I guess.
Absolutely. And I think that's something, as a course, it is evolving. And I think the more collaboration we have, and I think if not just Indian, but if you get other people, students from other countries to collaborate, nothing like it to be able to use this as a platform to launch different ventures, different ideas. And the self-learning part is very important, because I think it's always thought about as you know, something where I should be taught something. I should be taught a certain course, a certain way of learning. But if you actually explore, that's the best learning.
Exactly.
And I think that's what a course like this will offer. So the more I'm reading about it, the more interested I'm getting into how the layout is done. And the more the students you know, work on their own and find a problem, they own it, which is never a project which is given to you, will never own it. But if you start a problem and look at it, you start owning the problem. And that's something that I think all the students have been carrying a pride of owning their problem and then trying to solve it. So that's something that you see as a great, what you can say, in terms of satisfaction.
And
it's a pride, I would say, more than satisfaction. I have identified an issue. I have worked on it. I'm trying to solve it. So that's a great approach, I think.
It brings in a lot of maturity.
Absolutely.
At that time. So you have to identify where design is going to be relevant, how you're going to apply design, so what skills, what methods, what scale, etc. And I think it's the ideal context, and in that sense, added to modules that we mentioned before, this autonomy that one has to acquire is really preparing for being a design entrepreneur and a lead designer in different companies and studios.
I think that's a lot of, it is very experiential in the way of learning how to be a professional as well. Like, the next step would be to be a professional designer. So they would require all those modules and those steps and those experiences to get.
That's awesome. So
I think we have questions from the audience now.
Okay.
That I'm going to read out. So Jay is asking us, what job opportunities do I have after attending the program Transcultural Design?
Okay. I think one, what I would say as an outsider, in terms of not a core faculty, but looking at it from an industry point of view, is industries are looking at people who can really do good research. They can understand, articulate problems, because you have skilled designers who are really good in their skills. They're taught skills, but the approach that to build becomes very important. So I think the sky is the horizon, or sky is the limit, where you can, you know, go and see and understand where you can apply these skills. It could be even IT firms, it could be research firms, it could be design firms. And I think that's something that I look at, having looking at the industry and having been in the industry for some time. I see a lot of industries need people who understand different aspects of design and not just are master of one. So I think you would have some more understanding about it as well.
Yeah, no, that's really true. There's a, like we discussed, entrepreneurship is one model we are offering and allowing. So that would be setting up your own design studio, and where you would have clients, like you said, from different spheres of the economy, maybe medical sector, transport, tourism industry, environment. I mean, it's design can be and should be everywhere, if you agree with me. Then you can also integrate already existing design companies or work also in freelance as an advisor, as a user researcher, user experience, how a product, a service is experienced by people, and be able to decode that and improve aspects of the design of that product or service. That's a really, really high demand. We've had a project in partnership with a French company which works with heating system and air conditioning. They are not yet present in India. We worked with the team who works from Thailand. They are working in co-branding in India, and they we're really happy to have the students' perspective to understand India better, really to simplify the brief was, you know, what is India? Who are the Indians? And more specifically, of course, in the team was looking at water consumption and bathroom behaviors and heating services. And that gives one example of what career one can have and what type of clients one can have after the program.
Yeah, absolutely. And as I'd mentioned before, there's a company who, a French company again, who had come to India to understand colors of India. And it's a part of the Oxylon group. And as we see, Decathlon has come down. It was much prior to that. And they engaged students to understand how the culture is in India, how the colors are, how what should be their strategy. So it was way beyond, like, this was, Decathlon has been here for 2-3 years, I would say, or maybe 4 years. But it was like 10 years back when they were trying to start the research.
That's right,
so
yeah.
A lot of companies who are now looking at India as a canvas will look at a person or recruit a person who has these kind of skills. And this course would offer you those skills in terms of being able to build a portfolio which can tell the story about what all aspects you can cater to. And I think that's something important. Yeah.
Absolutely, because you're really looking at the purpose of design and where can design be useful, not only as a response, as a tangible solution, but also an entire strategy.
And in context of the culture,
yes,
which is more required.
I think we have another question from Sneha. Experiments always bring innovation to craft, but majority of craftsmen are rigid to their knowledge and skills. How can transcultural design help us ignite them? That's a very good question.
I'm not sure if craftsmen are really rigid to knowledge, but I think it's more, it has to do with the economy because everything else evolved, but craft wasn't able to evolve because of the economy. It wasn't that they didn't want to evolve. But one thing that I think the course allows is that it gives students the understanding of what are the crafts and how is it in the contemporary context of India, and how can designers play a role in helping them evolve with the cultural concepts or the new cultural ideas. And I think the role of designer there would be to innovate and also help them learn about those innovative steps or ideas or what other expanses they can move to.
At the same time, like, even understanding the problem as, you know, why, if the artisans are rigid, that's a great problem to solve in the first place. Why are they rigid? How can it be changed in a way? And that's something as a designer, you should be able to understand what makes them rigid, if they are.
Exactly,
what makes
them
rigid? What are the reasons? As you rightly pointed out, it was the economy. Maybe it was the lack of, you know, communication. It could be anything. But understanding and identifying that to a level that can be solved is the gist of it, right? So that's something that this, as you dig in more, you talk to people, and being an outsider, you are very, you are like an open canvas, you're a sponge, absorbing whatever information comes and trying to make sense. So it makes you learn more in a different culture. That's what I personally feel, that different culture more than what you would do, because you're comfortable in this environment, in your own culture. You have been subconsciously doing things. Whereas when you go to a different culture, you try to learn more, and maybe understanding artisans and trying to work with them becomes a different aspect altogether.
Yeah.
So really interesting to work it out and find a solution to it.
It's another form of collaboration.
Absolutely.
And anything to do with innovation has to do with collaboration. It's always side by side.
Yeah,
we always bring the students as part of the course to study a craft and understand. And in India, that's just so easy to do. Even here in Pune, you go to the old city, especially you have the copper craftsman community. It's really active, really impressive to see. So we definitely study that and understand. There are definitely things that craftsmen can learn to adapt to the demand. But for sure, there are things that designers must learn from artisans as well. And one part is also, how do we value this resource, this human resource, those skills, those you know, technical abilities that India has. It's one of the other major reasons I am here personally working in India, and the course about transcultural design is in India is also because of this rich patrimony and ability to respond also in a very sustainable, culturally relevant and also active way. So definitely it's important to integrate those people, craftspeople, in design processes and collaborate with them.
And I think students, as if I have to say, coming from the foreign land to see the craft, they would have a higher, I would say not hope, but a little bit of a value which might have gotten devalued, because as Indians we have been around it for so long that we have gotten inured to all the crafts. And yeah. One another thing I would say that designers can learn and often learn from that experience is, how do you document it before it dies, if it has to die? Mm-hmm. So I think those aspects are also very necessary for society in general, not just design only.
There are questions also, like, because you said dying, it's also how do you not only revive or preserve, but bring them into this adapting scenario, so that it's not only being dead or alive, it's activating and responding to this constant change. Nitesh is asking us, is transcultural design a new and technical way of social work? Amit, I guess you would have things to
first thing, no.
answer.
Because being a social entrepreneur, I think there's a big difference in between doing social work and doing social design or social entrepreneurship. So my own company, Plus One, is a for-profit social enterprise. So what that means is we are not an NGO as well. We are a company which makes money, but makes money trying to solve a social problem, which has been there for a while now. So and social work, as what I understand, is something which is devoted from your heart. It's something that you don't expect returns out of. Don't expect, or this is something that you would do out of your gut feeling, or doing something for good for the country or for the nation, or you know, for someone else. But a social enterprise can still help people, those in need. It can still help or cater to. So my enterprise would help those in need in terms by giving them more employment, by giving them sustained income, allowing them to make plans for their future by getting their kids to go to school, or you know, then. So that's how you can help in a social way. But that doesn't mean your company, if it's solving a problem, just be a social. So it should be social work and not get money out of it.
Yeah.
And there is no harm in, as I understand it, there's no harm in making a little bit of money to sustain yourself, to grow yourself by solving a problem, rather than generating more waste or generating something which is not good for the environment. Still work with the environment, with the people, those are in need, and then grow. So I think there is a great opportunity as a social entrepreneur, because now the government is helping, especially the Indian government is helping social entrepreneurs. There are forums, there are different incubators for social entrepreneurs to come up and build their ideas to take it to a reality. So that's something I see as more of an opportunity and not just social work. So that's what my take on it.
I think that the word, the definition of social work also sometimes needs to be relooked, and why we have associated to something which we do for no money.
Yeah.
I think the relook should be that design can sometimes generate a lot of waste for the environment, in the concept of nature and the destruction of nature. And we are not at a time in life where we can continue doing that. So one thing I would definitely say, that this course allows students to realize how they can work and also be environmentally conscious and not produce a lot of waste. Perhaps, let's say, one aspect can be that, or take on something which would help the people, but it doesn't necessarily need to be completely free, of course. But there needs to be a balance where you don't completely also go corporate in a way which can sometimes affect people negatively.
Yeah.
So I think that's one thing that this course allows. For
me, I think it's important to remind that design is social by nature. Any design, you are going to innovate and solve problems, and you're looking at the betterment of living condition in general. And I believe if the term social design has emerged, It comes from a gap that is too big, that too many people, too vast a strata of population has been overlooked by the design industry in the way designers can work for brands or on different products. So it's true that there is a really huge gap to bridge here. Yeah. And designers can very well work with social workers. They are colleagues maybe in a project. Just like sometimes designers work with bankers or with jet pilots. Yeah. And so that's again the idea of collaborating, where depending on the context, depending on the project, where the designer is going to be a team player in an existing system. I think we have another question. What type of internships Transcultural Design course offers to Indian students? So, like I said, there are two internships, which is at the first and the last semester of the Transcultural Design program. For Indian students, the first internship can be spent actually as a semester in France, so that's within the school. It's not an internship, it's a like an exchange semester, where you are going to be with other international students, other Indian students, Chinese students, Latin America, Eastern Europe, French also, because those programs are taught in English, of course. And there's also a demand from French students to study in English, even being in France. We're getting better at English. So that's an opportunity that is given to have this transcultural experience, like at the same time in both countries. Some students also from India, they prefer to do an internship because that's always, you know, a very good added value to your experience. And the last one, like I said, is trying to look as a continuation of the project that is being carried out on campus. So there's, of course, a pool of contacts. Students go to intern in design studios in Pune, Mumbai, Delhi, many places. I think a student is in Mysore right now, coming back very soon. So different scale of design studios, they might have a focus on furniture design. There are also design strategy studios who are conducting more user research in which students again of different profiles are joining, and they help the companies conduct user research for maybe Google, Amazon, Make My Trip. I think these are the projects they were mentioning. Some also choose to do research. They can join a lab in another university, not necessarily a design university. They might also join companies who have an in-house design team. It's really, really varied. It's not, I believe, difficult to find an internship in India. There's a lot of things going on, but it's difficult to choose the right one, depending on your own project, yeah.
Interesting.
Now, Vishnu is asking, when the world is insensitive to its own culture and people, to what extent can transcultural design bring change in the values of people?
Yes, I think it gives a methodology. And though people are not sensitive, what we feel now, people are not sensitive to their culture, they have their own take on the culture. I won't say they are insensitive, but they have a certain understanding and take on the culture. So what transculture design, according to me, is it gives you a methodology of understanding this. And it is very neutral. It is not something which will tell you that, okay, this is the right direction. It will allow you to gauge different aspects of different elements, and it will allow you to get the best out of it. So though we say that, and going back, that's what we also spoke, it's not a skill, it's an approach.
Right.
Like as we say, design thinking is an approach towards design. So similar, transcultural design is an approach. So it allows you to do your own research, do your own work in terms of being able to work towards building your own understanding for a certain problem. So Yes, I feel though people have their own take on the culture, transcultural design can build a methodology which can be propagated. If done well, can be propagated to many. So that's something that I feel.
I think also along with that, when some people from foreign, let's say, are kind of bringing out certain aspects of the Indian culture and pointing out that this is special, which we might have forgotten which was really special about India, that kind of brings us to again recognize and remind ourselves that we are in that same field and we have unique things as well.
Yeah.
And it's only when, sometimes it's only when someone else coming from outside points it out to us that we see it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
It's a very basic human behavior, I think.
Yeah,
yeah, that's true. Thank you. I think we'll take one last question from Neelam. What types of projects are taken by students pursuing this course? Do you want to maybe give examples, Ishita, of the end of study projects that are going on right now?
I think the end of study projects and the thesis projects were quite amazing to see. And they can work in any aspect of the culture, like let's say it could be disability and people with their, you know, human rights in India with disability. It could be the public spaces, like let's say the urban cities and how the mobility is in urban cities. Even women's rights when it comes to their body and also pregnancy and the format of pregnancy in the hospitals or relating to different classes and castes of that in the Indian context. I think some highlights of those projects have been that how students have taken forward that brainstorming and the mind mapping to understand some of the very important essential aspects of the culture and behaviors in the culture. Let's say it could be even like celebrating a festival, as simple like that. And how are people moving in the cities, like transportation, and how do you understand the culture through transportation, for example. And how did they go forward by interviewing people and documenting the data and building their critical thinking and the critical thought in that, and eventually then formulating a book finally.
Yeah.
And the fact which is really amazing is that they are able to do it in a language which is their foreign language for them.
Yeah.
And even for me, English is a foreign language, but to do that is actually quite an achievement. And it's an underrated achievement, I think, sometimes. But yeah, there are a lot of projects in all aspects of the culture, completely.
Yeah, I think I've seen majorly two main approaches. Some students identify quite soon issues or situations, phenomena that they are going to investigate really deeply and find what is the positioning they can have as a designer towards maybe solving this issue, resolving this this situation. And there's another approach which is more open in the beginning, which is getting interested in one aspect of India's culture. Students, for example, they have been looking at Ayurveda. Obviously, when you come from outside, you might have, you know, attended a yoga class here and there, but understanding the entire practice, way of life, and then the entire science, the mere dimension of Ayurveda, for example, is overwhelming. And those are also really truly transcultural projects, looking at such resources, such rich, you know, phenomena in India. And how, as a designer looking at the future, how do you innovate within or with, you know, resources that are borrowed or abstracted from, for example, from Ayurveda, which has, you know, applications for health, could be physical, also mental health, opportunities for education, opportunities even for city planning. It's limitless. Students also get interested in specific craft techniques.
Absolutely.
Then they get an understanding of the craft sector and how does it work and how is the craftsman time sometimes many times undervalued, how new generations are not likely to take up that profession ahead. Why is this happening, and how a designer valuing this craft and also as a valid response to situations of today. These are two main approaches I've seen. And we'll have actually the juries really soon. I'm looking forward to the outcomes and to further projects, obviously.
Awesome.
Thank you so much. It was a great discussion. I was happy to receive the question from the audience. It's interesting to see, you know, and decode what is transcultural design, what is it that we do in this course. Thank you so much for your insights.
I make the world graphical.
I add value through my products.
I am an animator.
I am a filmmaker.
I develop trends.
I transform designs to reality.
I create environments.
I translate stories to furniture.
I design experiences.
I'm an immersive media designer.
I design mobility.
This is not only a design institute.
This is a design lab.
Join us in our design.